spring of 1961, I followed and photographed Otis Terrell Overland in a region of forests and swamps, tall cypress and muddy riverbanks. The rivers had beautiful names, Bogachita, Tangipahoa, Bogafalaya, Tallahaley. To strangers, it was an empty, wild place. To Otis, it was his world, his life. Otis was a turtle hunter, a wilderness man, and someone I have never ceased to admire.
I built a house with a friend. We hauled two truckloads of peaches from Georgia to the New York market at Hunts Point. The fruit was too ripe for regular shippers, so we bought it cheap, and we drove nonstop up there and back. We got enough money to build the house and bring in electricity for the kids' TV and Alice's kitchen. The next thing I want to do is build an inside bathroom. Yeah, I always liked the sound of a jukebox. I saw a notice in the paper about they was auctioning off some jukeboxes, and I got this one. It's nice to walk around the woods and hear the music coming from the house. I've always wanted to live as much like my folks did as I could. My people are Oglethorpe Georgians, my mother says. They came to Georgia in the 1700s when James Oglethorpe started the colony. They were hunters and woodsmen. They liked the wilderness, and they put food on the table with their own hands, hunting, trapping, and selling furs. In those days, you couldn't go north. Over the mountains, there were hostile Indians, and south, with the Spanish. So over the years, they just moved west till they came here to Mississippi. Now we've been here a long time. When I got started hunting turtles, there wasn't no one around here doing that. Folks didn't even know such a creature lived here. My cousin Preacher got me started. He talked about how it was something they did down in Louisiana. He remembered his father hunting turtles. He watched him do it, but he didn't do it himself. Preacher couldn't do it himself. He had a bad heart, but he could tell me what he remembered about how it was done, especially how to make that three-pronged gaff and how really sharp it had to be. I couldn't live the way most folks live around here. I just want to live the way my daddy and granddaddy and his daddy did. I don't expect a lot, but I want to live as a natural man, barefoot and in the country. I can't stand shoes, and I don't know how folks live in the city. I never picked turtle gapping as something special I really wanted to do. It sort of came natural, and it is exciting, and I enjoy it to do it, because I do it better than anyone else, at least so far. Lewis and Buddy and all them that tried it don't seem to have the feel. Sometimes they get them on the hook, but they can't seem to keep them on and get them into the boat. I love being out in the woods and out on the river fishing or hunting or just looking. I'll mark where the wild turkeys hang out or the deer bed down. Sometimes I'll find a big berry patch or wild persimmon tree, and Alice will make a batch of jam. Turtle hunting is how I earn my living. I don't worry too much about other people catching them. They don't seem to have the knack. I guess the big ones can't last forever, but I think they'll be around longer than I will. Two things I had to learn really well: the ways of the river and how these big snappers lived and hunted in them. They like the long, still reaches of the river, without too much change in the current. But these rivers never stay the same. They're always rising or falling. Banks cave in, fallen trees block the way, channels change, bushes get torn loose and pile up. There's always new problems every time you hunt a stretch of it. You can only hunt going downstream because the current runs too fast to get back up. We worked it out so Preacher would drop me off upstream, and then he'd meet me somewhere 4 or 5 miles down below. If the water's too low, you can't get through. If it's too high, it runs too fast to hunt. Then when you get to these long, still stretches, you've got to read the water itself. You have to watch for the bubbles that tell you where they are. Some places along the river, I set out trot lines. Just a big hook and a line tied to a bush with a chunk of fish for bait. I catch smaller turtles that way. Folks down in the market in New Orleans will take all of them I can get. The big one, though, you gotta use the gaff hook. They'll tear that trot line all up, and they'll bite right through the shank of a hook. They got so much muscle in their jaws, they'll bite right through a pine board. Take your toe, too, if you let them. There was one stretch of the Tallahassee that ran by a flat, grassy bank with big, shady trees growing there. I swear it looked just like a park. Every time I'd go through there looking for turtles, I'd see turkeys scratching in the grass and feeding. Sometimes a lot, sometimes a few. Turkeys are real smart birds. They spook real easy. I'd drift down that stretch, quiet, minding my own business, and I guess they got used to me. So I took my shotgun with me when turkey season opened. And when I reached that spot, I stood up and drifted on by till I got just to the right place, and then blam, blam, We had us a couple of real nice turkeys that fall. I never hunted anything for the market except turtles. Most of the time it was just to put food on the table. When turtles move around, they disturb old leaves and stuff on the river bottom and release a line of bubbles behind them as they move. You have to gauge these bubbles to guess where that fella is. Turtles breathe air and they release air bubbles from time to time as they lay still on the bottom. That's a different looking kind of bubble, bigger, more round, and you go straight into them with your gaff hook when you see them. There's a lot more to it than that, but that's where you start. And they all got their own little habits though. Gaffing a turtle takes a real touch. You gotta feel that guy right down the pole. If you feel something push back on your pole, you gotta guess which part of the turtle you're touching. The only part of a turtle's tough hide that hook and snag and hold on is the fleshy folds between the neck and the shoulder. If you miss that, he usually gets away. You get him in the rear and he'll tear loose every time. In the shoulder, he'll push into it instead of pulling away. Thank you. Getting together every once in a while and visiting is something folks here like to do. Cousins, aunts, uncles, friends, just visiting and talking of this and that. Kids playing in the yard. And if you want a big enough pile of food to feed them all, frog legs are the easiest to get and what they all like to eat. There's more frogs around here than anything else. You fill up a sack in no time. It's sweet white meat, better than chicken. I like being near my family best of all. I guess I'm not entirely happy unless I'm with Alice and the kids. When I'm away hauling peaches or something, they're always on my mind. I don't hardly ever spend a night away from home. I remember one time when we were kids, we had a frog roast at Grandpa's house. Grandpa lived alone, and me and Buddy stayed over. Later that night, we got really thirsty, and there wasn't a drop of water in the house. Grandpa was asleep in the rocking chair, snoring like a runaway locomotive. We couldn't wake him up. It was really dark outside. We wanted to go out to the well for water, but there was owls hooting and all kinds of scary sounds. Buddy saw a little bottle of powdered quinine on the mantel, and Grandpa was sleeping with his head back and his mouth wide open. We figured the bitter taste would surely wake him, so we sprinkled a good bit on his tongue and hoped he'd wake up and go to the well with us. He began snorting and smacking his lips and coughing and sputtering. Pretty soon he woke up and looked around till he saw us. "Boys, I think I done busted my gallbladder," he said, and went right back to sleep. Thank you.
watch Otis and Preacher going to market that long ago day, I think of the changes our world has seen. Throughout its historic range, the alligator snapping turtle is now protected. To me, as to most of us in the 60s, nature seemed boundless, and the adventuresome and enterprising individuals who reaped its bounty were admirable. They lived in the wilderness as their forefathers had, free and independent. Sadly, population growth and environmental devastation have become big facts of life, and Mother Nature needs our love and consideration now more than ever.
Hi, this is Ron Schira, and I am at the Freiberger Gallery of Penn State University. And I have Marilyn Fox, the director of the Freiberger Gallery, right with me. And I'd like to talk about the exhibit that's taking place in here now. Hi, Marilyn. It's with Steven Siegel.
Yes.
Now, Steven is a sculptor, and he does a lot of work that is associated with wrapped and fabric style art, although he uses a lot of different materials in it. There's cords, wire, mirrors, beads, all kinds of active things going on in here. But I'd like to get a little bit from Marilyn here and have a better description of what Steven does, because this is a three-part extravaganza exhibit that's taken place over at the Albright College Friedman Gallery and also at the Goggle Works for the Cohen Gallery. So,
And that's because there was way too many pieces for this gallery to support. So when I looked at the catalog and got to know Stephen, and I worked with the Tertian Center of Visual Arts at Appalachian State College in Boone, North Carolina. When I saw the amount of work, this was a couple of years ago, Stephen and I actually were in touch for several years before we could make our calendars connect, but it was too much for this gallery. I couldn't put all the pieces in, so I started to look for other venues that would want to collaborate. So Stephen Siegel from Red Hook, New York, based this collection of works on a book called Wonderful Lies, I think that's his name, which was a book about a biological study of fungus in British Columbia, where a type of fungus was discovered, or actually fossil of fungus, that didn't exist anywhere else on the planet, and because of that, it had unique characteristics, because this particular fossil didn't show any signs of natural or unnatural predators that would change or influence the way that it reproduced. So he took the idea of the cell and let it grow and grow and grow and mutate on its own or grow with its own kind of agenda. So that's pretty much what all of his was. And he's an ultimate craftsman and uses weaving and wrapping and stuffing and in a sense very feminine type of materials like yarn and beads and glittery mirrors, and you know, there's a real feminine sensibility to this, which, you know, probably developed from exposure to the feminist art movement in the 70s, where traditional women's craft moved into the status or was recognized more as a fine art. Things like weaving and hand work, like embroidery, crocheting, things like even like ceramic painting, things like that. So I think, you know, had that movement not happened, perhaps these would be made out of steel or marble or plastic or something else. But there's a nice tangible quality to them in the sense that you do want to touch them. You do want to like kind of feel the different twines and ropes and strings. Although I'm not
going to
encourage it.
No, but my goodness, there's a lot of... This is incredibly worked.
52 pieces over 6 years. So, a little bit short of 10 pieces per year. So 10 pieces per year,
a little more than a month to produce each piece.
That's, wow. That's, you know, that's a real rough kind of estimate based on the time that it's going on pieces and how many trips he makes to the home season.
Amazing.
We were talking about how they have like really like poor quality pieces, which it wouldn't work in a different material, I don't think.
Well, they, how heavy are these things? They're not, they don't
about
seem...
50 pounds.
50 pounds each?
Yeah. Some little...
Yeah.
And they all are, the center of balance is amazing because they're all done, they're all put up with one hook that he incorporates into the work. So they're actually really an easy show to handle for an installation. And very nice to light. He does like the play of the shadows.
Play of shadows really adds something to it.
And you can't not have that kind of shadows when you have this multi-dimensional work.
Oh no! You have to be able to show the volumes on it.
It does it automatically, you know. You can't kind of get around it.
Wow. Well. Okay. Well, thank you very much. Thank you, Marilyn. Okay, we are over at the Friedman Gallery now for the third installment of the Stephen Siegel exhibit. Now, these pieces are much larger. And, well, they fit much better in the large gallery space here. However, they're much more complicated too. Inside of this one, looks like actual circuit boards, mirrors. Tubing. It's called Xena. This one. So far, this one is my favorite. Now, this large oven mitt here is called Dave. Over here, we have Zelig. Kinds of found objects in here. There's more computer circuit boards, tubing, wrapping, wire, plugs, tape, beads, cord, UMA. Wire connectors. This piece is called Carol. You can see the size in relationship to the door that's right next to it. So these are fairly large pieces. In this one over here, you can get a little closer and take a look at the title. Also, to take a look at the ingredients. It has hundreds of corks and looks like buttons and washers and beads and more cord, wire, filler, some fabric. This one's called Winona. Clyde. Now one can see the references to the biological here. This one's called Jan. All kinds of yarn. Fibers, filaments. This piece is called Tracy. Now this piece here has it. Cornucopia sort of feel to it, although it may not have been his intention. But it has a whole bunch of stuff cradled inside of this armature with wiring and orbs and all kinds of different things, kind of like burrowing through it, almost a sea life sort of pod container. This one's called Jaeger. And this piece is called Walker. More cork, wire. And another thing about these is it's abstracted formation, even though they have this type of biological association to it. I also feel a little bit of Frank Stella in here and Elizabeth Murray and that whole ambiguity of paint versus objectivity, sculpture, sort of a duality of the objects that hang on a wall but look like they're painted. They have all kinds of linear and formal aspects to them. What they... definitely have a certain mass to them. They're about 50 pounds each, I understand. And these here sell for up to $14,000. Okay, this is the final piece of the show that we're going to look at. This is called Venia. He took 6 years to complete this project, at which time he spent about a month on each one. Now, that whole painterly thing, really very strong right in this area here with the different colors. Really plays with that. Works very well with it, too.
I'm Ron Schira, and we are at Gallery 908 on 8th Street, 908 8th Street, in Reading, Pennsylvania. And we're going to see an exhibit called Prayer Flags, Aspirations.
Okay, we're in the gallery now, and to our left is Peg Spears, and to our right is Nancy Sarangulis, who is Peg is the owner and director of the gallery, and Nancy is a curator. So, hi, how are you?
Hi.
Hi, Ron.
Hi. Glad you could stop by.
Yeah, I'm glad I could stop by, too. So, anyhow, talk to me about this exhibit. This is called Aspirations, Prayer Flags.
Visual Aspirations, Artist Prayer Flags. And I had the idea to do a fundraising art show, and I decided that since the money would go to benefit a Tibetan temple, that I would use the theme of prayer flag, because prayer flags are things that you see at Tibetan temples, and but my version would be to ask artists to make their own personal prayer flags rather than traditional ones. And so I asked a lot of artists to make a prayer flag that was 11 by 14 inches, and the idea would be to just get as many different kinds as I could. I wanted a wide variety, and I said that they don't have to be religious, but they should contain a prayer or an aspiration and be kind of positive. And then we just strung them up in Gallery 908,
and here they are. Yeah.
And here they are.
Okay. Well, let's take a look at a few of them. Maybe you want to talk about a couple of them? Where should we start? Over here, Saint?
Okay, yeah. You have any questions, just ask.
Okay.
So pretty much everybody is just putting something in here, which is like a prayer to the universe. Let's see, this one says, respect life, go foe.
Yes, and this is made out of fake fur.
Fake fur.
And the words are snipped away with the scissors.
Ah.
So and that's made by Daniel Schlenker.
Okay.
Who's very talented. And this one's by Nancy Sagetti, and mm-hmm. she actually took this photograph of Buddha when she was in Vietnam, I think.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, she's been overseas a few times. She's now over in India, I believe.
Mm-hmm. This is Suzanne Calvaresi, mm-hmm. and it's kind of like, it's a print. It's a, I don't know what it's called. It's a monoprint.
Mm-hmm.
Process, I can't remember. And this is Mary Stout, who's a quilt maker.
Mm-hmm.
And she makes these, and she doesn't call them prayer flags, but she's been making them for years, and
mm-hmm.
she just said, sure, I'll give you some. And they have like little quotations on them.
Mm-hmm. This one says, charm is a way of getting the answer yes without asking a clear question. Okay, yeah, it's a quote from Camus. Okay, this one says, make
it.
This is,
I think it's called For Buddy. It's made by Susan Duby, and it's hair from her horse.
Mm-hmm.
And she got the idea because traditional Tibetan prayer flags are called wind horses.
Mm-hmm.
And they carry the Dharma or the teachings on the wind.
Mm-hmm.
And she has this horse who's very dear to her, and so she made a wind horse with so actual horse
like hair. There's a few here that you made, I know. What do you call these, 8 auspicious symbols? Is that what?
Yes, I made a Buddhist one. We have something called the 8 auspicious symbols.
Mm-hmm.
And so I made 8 prayer flags, and I put the kind of like a Western image of the Buddhist symbols on them to give them kind of a modern, mm-hmm, or offbeat kind of look.
Modern twist.
Yeah, this wheel is represents the Dharma wheel,
mm-hmm,
which is the teachings of the Buddha, and the fish represents a flexible mind.
Mm-hmm. Cornucopia.
That's a shell.
Uh-huh.
When the Buddha, had a shell that he would blow to call his disciples together.
So it's a call to faith?
Yes. And this is a lotus. That's the victory banner. I think there are eggs in there. Little tiny eggs. I don't know.
The eggshells, it looks like something.
Mm-hmm. Carl Klingbeil, mm-hmm, who's a Brooklyn artist, and a woodblock prince, and he's a Buddhist, and he made drawings of monks and adepts,
mm-hmm,
kind of real loose drawings, gesture drawings, and mm-hmm, so he made these prints using those.
He had some other ones on the other side here that he did,
yeah,
as woodblock prints,
yes,
except
yes,
that he actually engraved these with a router.
Mm-hmm.
Pretty interesting.
And these two down here are also by high school students from Wyomissing, and they're memory pieces,
mm-hmm,
in honor of friends and sister who died.
Oh.
Ed Terrell, who actually lived in an ashram in India for 13 mm-hmm years.
Victoria Sykes.
Victoria Sykes, who works here.
Yes.
And she's a high school student, too.
She just graduated.
Oh,
yeah, pretty cool.
Mm-hmm. And that's Paletta, artist from Westchester.
Mm-hmm. And an occasional collaborator of yours.
Yes. Do you remember this one?
Melissa Kepner. She was an elementary art teacher in Reading, so she's now working for AmeriCorps, and she's in Phoenix.
Jane Runyon and Marie DePhillips.
Mm-hmm.
This is Ellen Moret, who actually took this photograph on Mount Kailash in Tibet, and that's a sacred mountain that they walk around. It takes a week to walk around there.
Mm-hmm.
Another Wyomissing high school student.
Nice colors in that.
This is Beverly Leviner. Strength, silence, will, peace, patience. And this is, who's this?
Mine.
Peg Spears.
I did this one, yeah.
And you can say with
it's a Native American medicine wheel. So the four directions, the aspects of self and mind, body, and spirit. So spirit is the east, and that's fire, and water is south, and that's your emotion, and body is west, and that's the earth, and air is north, and that's our mind. And it's about seeking balance,
you know,
in the center.
DeSantis, it's called emptiness.
And it actually is emptiness. Julio is a well-respected conceptual artist around here who sometimes does not actually use any materials at all. And this is what his contribution is.
These are stones. They're carved by a Tibetan friend of mine named Tupa.
And he's a traditional Buddhist, and Deborah Gray, and they just got back from Bhutan, and they took these photographs in Bhutan, and it contains the four immeasurables, we call them, may all beings be happy, may they be free from suffering, may they experience sorrowless bliss, may they dwell in equanimity.
Lord Donald Mann, and she has these wonderful images in the Venus figure that she's referencing, Tara, Green Tara.
Mm-hmm. This is from the Venus of Willendorf, is that correct? Yeah, it was the very first carving ever to be found of, you know, from ancient society.
Very much.
Okay.
This is Ron Schira with another Art Geek production, and we are with Nancy Sarangoulis and Peggy Spears. Thank you very kindly.
Thank you.
Hi, this is Ron Schira. I'm at Gallery 908 for the exhibit of Rachel Chambers and Craig Zuri, the joint collaborative effort where Chambers has taken Zuri's poetry and printed that out or collaged it onto pieces of silk and then placed it under fabrics that she created herself either by loom or knitting. Now this is a piece of Zuri's poetry, and Zuri is a well-known exhibit around this area and has been involved with a number of different projects. This says, it was easier to believe I'd become someone else, as if from a dream, waking into a question of my voice. Each one of these has a segment of Zuri's poetry that inspired Chambers, and she has taken them and attached them to these pieces of silk here. In the evening, the air stiffens, and the ceiling stiffens its pool of sap that also looks like a window. A huge fish with bird, beak, a wolf. I strike a small fire in the center of books, pleat, muslin around my body, not tired for sleep, but draw this half-light close against the cold. Now some of these are meant to be read right through the fabric. And others, like this one here, is attached to pieces of paper onto a slab of beeswax. It breaks a little bit from the knitting aesthetic, but she has all the words to a certain poem attached to these papers, and they're embedded in the beeswax. And one like this has to be read through. Now, none of these pieces are titled, although Zuri's poems do have titles to them. These pieces are all meant to accentuate certain passages in his poems. Now, this piece here has everything right on top, and it says, I need to hear someone speak who can really delay the background noise. Place and destination are completely unavailable for a while. To hear the action, you make surrendering attention. Now there's certain items inside of this too. It looks like little buttons and actual razors are placed inside of this. Also implicit to this character of the show is the need to have a white noise in the background, something like a radio tuned between stations and have a sort of a multiplex hiss go on in a mindless background hum. This says, between sleep and waking, dream erases death. Between window and mirror, sand dissolves fire into seeing. Between your voice and silence, you become an echo. And in the dark behind your eyes, you become an echo. This This piece here just has one word behind it. It says click. And notwithstanding the abstract qualities in all of these pieces and the layering of fabric over fabric and wording, pretty interesting little conceptual works. And we have 12 pieces throughout the entire show. And this is the exhibit Palimpsest by Rachel Chambers and Craig Zori. I thank you very much. I'm Ron Schira.